to actually bring up Bill King, who is the person that coordinated this, to introduce our guest speaker.
Thanks for having us. I actually am a member of the Boston AS group, which you probably haven't seen a lot of me the last couple of years, but we show up once in a blue moon. Talking with Tony a few weeks ago, actually several months ago, we talked about, could we help with your monthly events and bringing up people to come up and present in front of you, and we mentioned Ken. He does such an outstanding job with wireless seminars. And Tony and I spoke a few weeks ago, and I realized that Tim was in town this week, so we were able to get him to stay and do his presentation for you. Tim is one of Shore's senior wireless engineers. He has literally traveled the world talking wireless and coordinating wireless for things like people like the Rolling Stones and whoever. So, without further ado, Tim Beer.
Do we want audio from this thing? Is there audio from this thing?
I don't think so. Does it matter?
Doesn't matter. Unless they want it to record or something. It's not necessary. If you get that fine, then we'll just go with what we've got here. I hate using wireless anyway. Although I like to use it because often something will go wrong and I will learn something. So I'll try to do it a cappella here. All right. We're going to talk about these sort of three areas. Spectrum things, what's going on these days, radio spectrum in this country. Some examples of frequency coordination, one here in Boston, actually, which might be entertaining. And then we'll talk about antennas, which are ultimately kind of a part of the system that will make or break it. The one part of the system where you can really do some good or you can really screw it up. So we'll look at those things. So we'll get into the spectrum stuff first because things are still updating here. Three areas of interest. The DTV transition, which is largely complete. The 700 megahertz reallocation, which is sort of part of that. And white spaces devices, if anybody has heard of these things. And we'll see where these things are going. Okay. By way of background, we, that is wireless mic, in-ear monitors, wireless intercom, and things like that, are mostly in the broadcast UHF television spectrum. And we like that part of the ether because it's kind of a sweet spot where you've got good propagation characteristics of radio waves. That is, they can penetrate obstacles to some extent, human bodies, walls, a little bit, furniture, and so forth. But the wavelengths are short enough that the antennas are of manageable size. If you go to higher frequencies, you have not as good propagation characteristics because the wavelengths are getting much shorter, so they tend to be easily blocked and absorbed by obstacles. If you go to lower frequencies, where you actually might have better propagation, the wavelengths are so long, the antennas become unmanageable. AM radio antennas, a real one, would be about 50 feet long. So that's not a good thing to be trailing behind your lapel microphones. So, yes. So we like this spot. It's kind of the sweet spot. But of course, for the same reasons, other entities are interested in using these frequencies. Right now, and for the last 60 years or so, this part of the spectrum has been reserved for broadcast television. Parts of it have been chopped off in the past. And another part just got chopped off the past year. And we can expect that perhaps some other parts might get chopped off in the future, but not anytime soon. All right. And the other feature of this slide is that this is the largest contiguous block of spectrum that we have access to. Any of these other areas are divided up into many, many users in many, many small slots. So to get the amount of spectrum that we typically need for a big show, there's just not another big chunk available anymore. So this is pretty much where we like to be, at least for the time being.
Okay. Now, where?
Yes.
Where exactly are things you guys are using the TV 14 to 69?
Yes.
Or were?
Yes.
And this
the dotted line is
2D6.
Analog and digital devices can operate in that.
Now, television, after the DTV change, is still using this?
Yes, and here we go. So, up until June 12th of last year, we had all of this area, and post June 12th, we have this much area. So we lopped off about a third of it. So this is TV channels 14 through 51 in the UHF spectrum. The blue areas are licensed wireless bands, although this is slightly changed now. But traditionally, we have preferred to be in licensed bands because the only traffic that you need to worry about there are broadcasters or other licensed users. And those are easy to suss out and work around. The yellow areas, like 49 meg and 902 meg and so forth, that's all unlicensed spectrum and tends to be completely overrun by consumer electronic devices, making it hazardous for running professional events that need to work in a predictable manner. Just so you don't feel too put upon, in Japan, this is all they've got. 22 megahertz total for wireless mics, in-ear monitors, wireless intercom, video assist, all that stuff has to fit in this little 22 megahertz, little three little bands. So the U.S. still has quite a lot of open spectrum.
Pretty high.
Yeah, it's at the top of what would have been our upper portion of the UHF spectrum.
Is that for their exclusive use, though?
Pardon?
Do they have to share that with other
devices? Ah, they only operate wireless microphones in there. So this is clean for wireless mic use, but 22 megahertz is not a lot of spectrum if you have to put up 50 or 60 channels of wireless. We're still in pretty good shape. We did that, let me know here. For those who have historical interest, this is what an analog television transmission used to look like. 6 megahertz wide in the U.S. and other NTSC countries, and consisted of three carriers, a video carrier, audio carrier, and a little color carrier. These two, the video and chroma, are actually AM signals. The audio is a standard FM signal, just like FM radio. It was possible, although not technically legal, if you needed a little bit of extra spectrum, you could stick a couple wireless microphones in here, or maybe in there, and you could get away with it, because there wasn't a lot of energy in there in analog broadcast. Again, not technically legal, but it was a useful trick if you were running out of spectrum. This is now historical, and then replaced by digital television signals. And DTV signals occupy the entire 6 megahertz chunk, with no gaps. There's usually a little timing mark that is visible on most of these. And the problem, of course, is that when one of these guys fires up, that 6 megahertz chunk is gone for our purposes. So the DTV stations do really need to be avoided in their entirety if you are close enough to one of them or it shows up on your spectrum analyzer.
Now, is this for HD TV or is this for standard broadcast?
All four channels. All
digital television broadcasts can consist of an HD signal, several standard definition signals, plus numerous audio and data channels along with it, but all multiplexed into the same overall signal. So this could be any of those things.
Rejoice and multiplex.
Yes. Now, if we want to look at some of this, and let me turn off. Did I leave this thing on?
I did. Let me turn it off.
Okay. We can actually see what's on the air here. Wake up, there you go, good dog. This spectrum analyzer is hooked up to that antenna on the other side of that post. I don't know where downtown Boston is from here. That way? Okay, so I'm sort of in that direction. So this is the entire UHF television spectrum from channel 14 at 470 megahertz up to channel 69 at 806 megahertz. So the things that we are looking at here are digital television stations for the most part. The 700 megahertz band begins around here, and there is something up there right now. We'll come back to the discussion of that in a minute. But, there is already some operation going on in the 700 megahertz band, which was auctioned off to various telecommunications companies. And we'll look at that in a little bit more detail. But this thing here is a precursor of why you want to get out of the 700 megahertz band sooner rather than later, if you want to have reliable operations. But we can look in a little bit more. Oh, and see this thing that just came up here?
Let me put us into the lower portion of this band.
Okay. This is a 60 megahertz chunk, which is 10 television channels in this country. And it's TV channels 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, yes? Is that right? Okay. So, you may see some activity here in channel 14 and also, I think, in 15 because these two chunks are used by public safety operations in Boston. The 13 largest markets in the U.S., formerly largest markets, have had public safety operations in the 14 through 20 range for many years, and those continue to be there. There is new public safety operation up in the 700 megahertz band. That's one of the things we need to stay away from. But
when you say public safety, you're talking fire, police.
Fire, police, ambulance, defense, civil defense, all that stuff.
Security.
And occasionally you'll see a little thing poke up down here because these transmissions, that's right, it's in 14 and 16. These tend to be intermittent transmissions. So, again, legally, we are prohibited from operating in active public safety channels. So in Boston, for instance, you can't, well, there's somebody just popped up in 14. You shouldn't operate in 14 or 16, I believe, are the two local ones. There's somebody in 16. But 15 and 19 are fine in the rest of this. Now, this is DTV, and we could look more closely at, let's see, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. Channel 18 will be at 494 to 500. So if we go 494 to 500 megahertz, that's our DTV signal. There's a little timing mark that we expect, and this is the whole 6 megahertz occupied. So this is what they all look like. You'll see fluctuations like these little dips here. That's due to multipath. And in an extreme case, if the multipath null gets deep enough, you'll lose the transmission. If you're near that antenna that's on the top of that post, could you tilt it 90 degrees horizontally, please?
So you'd expect that to be flat but noisy if there wasn't any.
There.
If we were if we were outside, there was no buildings or anything.
Right. But notice when he tilted the antenna at 90 degrees, the level of the station went up. Because of the polarization angle of the television transmission in this case, which is horizontal, so the horizontal antenna is more sensitive to it. We'll look at that a little bit more when we talk about antennas later. But this is what you're up against, the DTV signal in that chunk.
Okay.
Now let me go back to this. Okay. So, on June 12th of 2009, most of the analog television broadcasts ended, and only the DTV stations remained, except low power and Class A translators, repeaters, are not required to go to digital yet. So there's some low power analog TV stations still on the air, which can be an issue in specific locations if you happen to be nearby one of these things. So after that, everybody who watches over the air television needed to have some sort of a converter or a digital TV to tune those signals from here. I'll ask my survey question. How many people here watch terrestrial broadcast, meaning over-the-air television with an antenna?
In Vermont, not here.
Okay. This proves my point. AES guys like to hang on to that free television. Now, I didn't say the word cheap. I just say the word hang on to that high-quality terrestrial broadcast, which is fine. But we realize, of course, that only about 15% of the American population is still watching over-the-air television. Everybody else is on cable or satellite. And this is part of the political problem that continues. So in Boston, back before last June 12th. These were the analog TV channels that were on the air. They're DTV assignments that had been active for several years. So all of this stuff was on the air up to last June. And then on that June 12th date, all these guys went away. Only these guys remained, except a couple of stations went back to their original analog assignments, but now with a digital signal. And this has been a little problematic in some cases. And that's because in Chicago and New York, for example, Channel 7 is the ABC affiliate. And they did the same thing. They had a digital station up in the 40s somewhere, went back to 7, fired up their DTV transmitter, and didn't get nearly as much coverage as they had planned. This turns out to be due to some calculation errors on the part of the FCC, but this caused these stations to be unhappy and get a lot of complaints from their viewers who couldn't see them. So in several cities, and this is continuing, although just sporadically, some VHF DTV stations are reassigning themselves up into the UHF spectrum. So in Chicago and New York, for example, those Channel 7s have moved up to either TV44 or TV45.
But they're in the UHF spectrum.
They're still in the UHF spectrum. They've moved from the VHF spectrum back up to the UHF spectrum because they get better coverage.
Channel 7 in the UHF spectrum?
No, no, this is not UHF. This is a combination of UHF and VHF.
Right.
These are just DTV. These are all digital.
It's still 14 and above is UHF, right?
Yes, yes. So it has turned out, for those of you who still have VHF wireless systems, the VHF spectrum is quite vacant right now. So this is a good time to have VHF wireless systems, and probably will continue to be a good time to have VHF wireless, because most VHF television stations have exited that part of the range.
And that's all unlicensed, of course.
Pardon?
That's all licensed or unlicensed.
Well, it's still licensed, technically, at a certain power level, and that's where we're going here. We don't need that. So this is the way it is here in Boston. So these are all DTV channels, but there's still quite a lot of open television here, which means we can do big wireless productions without too much trouble. And here's your public safety guys. But what has happened to the former TV channels 52 through 69? It was not possible to have adjacent analog TV channels because they would interfere with each other due to the discrete carriers and get intermodulation problems. So there was always at least one or more open TV channels between any two active television channels. And this is where we operate. This provided a convenient playground for all of our wireless stuff. But digital stations can operate adjacent to each other. And so it is possible to pack the DTV stations into a smaller portion of the spectrum than we can do with analog, and this provides what in Europe is called the digital dividend, meaning a bunch of extra spectrum that we can now use for something else potentially. And if we look at our spectrum analyzer here again and bump the stop frequency up to 506, we'll see a second DTV channel. So this is 18 and 19. So this is channel 18, this is channel 19. And they're perfectly happy being right next to each other. But this means that this whole 12 megahertz chunk is pretty much out of bounds, although you could potentially put something on a channel. A little tricky. Because they pretty much go right up to the edge of the 6 megahertz channel. So this is, again, what we're up against with DTV signals. Okay. So here's what happened when the digital dividend was parceled out. We started with analog and digital throughout UHF spectrum. We chopped it just to this portion of the spectrum, 14 through 51, DTV only. For completeness sake, channel 37 is reserved for radio astronomy in this country. So no television operations there, and no wireless mic operations. If you have a US-built, US-legal wireless system, it will not be able to tune into TV37. The upper portion first was allocated two sections of spectrum for public safety operations. This is in the wake of 9/11, when one of the big problems in the aftermath was that public safety agencies, meaning police, fire, ambulances, civil defense, all these guys, could not talk to each other on their radios. Their radio systems were not interoperable. So if I'm a cop here and there's a fireman over there and we both got radios, we can't talk to each other because the radio systems are not compatible. So this was deemed to be an issue. And so this portion of the spectrum is now reserved for future public safety operations to create a nationally interoperable series of public safety radio systems. So that's where these two chunks are dedicated. And this is basically what used to be channel 68 and 69 and channel 63 and 64. A good reason to not operate up there if you've got wireless systems in that range. You really don't want to trample on the public safety guys. More realistically, they would be trampling on you because they have much higher power levels than we'll have. The rest of it was auctioned off to various telecommunications companies for new services, streaming video, data services, and other things. So this whole chunk from 698 to 806 is generally referred to as the 700 megahertz band. And if you have wireless in wireless mics or in-ears, whatever, in this band, the question was, when do we have to get out of the pool? And this past January, the FCC finally laid down the law and said everybody out of the pool on June 12th of this year, 2010. Otherwise, anywhere in the core television band, things are good. These are the folks who bought that spectrum, and they paid about $20 billion for it. So we expect. And back in the day, $20 billion used to be a significant amount of money. Not so much anymore. But at the time, they thought this would be a great source of revenue. Of course, you know, it's nothing these days. But in any event, they did pay all this money. And so they're going to build out their infrastructure in here. But it's going to take them probably several years to complete building this up out. Because this is like cell phone tower-like things that will operate these services. But Qualcomm, AT&T, and Verizon are the big auction winners. These two little blocks, the D block, the white ones, didn't actually get auctioned off and are likely to remain vacant for a while. And that is because the auction requirements on these two chunks, the D block, were that whoever bought that had to be willing to relinquish it for public safety operations on an as-needed basis. This was not a good business model for the potential investor, and so they didn't get any sufficient bids. So those little chunks are presently unaccounted for. The rest of it is all gone from our standpoint. What will they do with this stuff? They'll do mobile television and some data things and a variety of things. It's hard to say. They don't really have to explain it all just now. They're building it out for a variety of things. It's worth noting that one of the operations has been active for several years, and this is Qualcomm MediaFlow streaming television service. Verizon calls it VCast, and there are several carriers that have this function. And it looks kind of like a DTV signal. And in fact, if we look at TV 55, they have 55 and 56 in most parts of the country. So if we scroll down to TV 55 and bring this up, this is the Qualcomm signal on TV 55. Again, this is a 6 megahertz chunk. Notice that that signal doesn't go all the way to the boundary. There's a little bit of room at each end, but it exhibits a typical DTV kind of pattern, but without the timing mark. That's how you possibly distinguish it. And if I go back to the complete spectrum view here, that's this thing. That's the Qualcomm MediaFlow TV 55 digital signal. You can buy a little mobile phone-like thing from LG and a couple other companies. and you can watch television on it. And you will see more advertising going forward. They'll call it mobile TV. This is very popular in Japan and some other countries, but in this country, we're typically well behind the curve on telecommunications. But you'll start to see these things in your Best Buy and so forth. Now, why you'd want to watch television on a device that big, I just don't understand.
My death.
Right. But that's going to fill up this portion of the spectrum in some cases. Now, lest you think that these are not a problem because it's kind of weak compared to these DTV stations, these things are not transmitted from a central location like a television station. They are distributed around on cell phone towers. And so each one is relatively low power, but you're never going to be very far away from one. So if we were outdoors here, I would expect to see this thing somewhat stronger than it is. And as I moved out of Boston, the strength of these things would decrease, because these are all coming from downtown somewhere. But this thing would be about the same power as it was yesterday in wherever we were. Where were we? Westminster, about 50 miles out of town. This was the strongest thing on the air. It was pretty good size. Couldn't see hardly any TV from Boston, but this guy was probably no more than a mile away in some cell tower. So that's the kind of thing that we'll be looking at in the 700 megahertz spectrum, plus the public safety operations that will be occurring here. Okay. So, in January, they issued this end date, which is June 12th, and they also established a temporary licensing scheme for wireless audio systems. Now, the licensing thing is of some interest, but this is more germane here. Legally, you really have to stop using this stuff on June 12th. From a practical standpoint, you'll probably be able to continue to use it for a year, 2 years, maybe 3 years, before the telecoms build out all this stuff. In an effort to be a good corporate citizen and encourage people to kind of move along, many wireless manufacturers have offered rebate programs and other incentives for people to trade in their old 700 megahertz stuff and operate on a legal band. So this is the rule. The other change, and manufacturers have to stop building this stuff. And an interesting part of the restriction is manufacturers cannot ship this equipment within the U.S. You can still manufacture and ship it for export, yes, but we cannot ship this equipment in the U.S. And that means we cannot repair it legally anymore. So no manufacturer in the U.S. can even repair 700 megahertz equipment any longer legally. So another thing to consider going forward, when it does break, it is truly dead at that point, at least for this country. Okay.
Do they expect this equipment to get sold in the foreign market now, and it all ends up in Thailand?
Well, what does happen to 700 megahertz stuff? Things that come into manufacturers for rebate type operations are, at least theoretically, recycled in a responsible way. Many users from the church community will send their 700 megahertz equipment to their foreign missions and operations in other countries, because this is not occurring in the same time frame in the U.S. So, but within the U.S., now we're starting to see a lot of this stuff on eBay,
right.
And you don't want to go there. In Canada, they're a little bit behind the U.S., but not far, maybe a year or two. South America, probably 10 years away. But all around the world, this is occurring to some extent.
So all these $100 systems you see are essentially this junk that's going to be illegal?
Well, yeah. A lot of the stuff see on eBay and Craigslist is 700 megahertz stuff. But the FCC also took action on a long standing request to clarify the licensing issue around wireless microphone operations. Technically, from the beginning of time, 1960s at least, operating a wireless microphone in the broadcast band required a license, an FCC, a low power auxiliary station license. And the form and the information for this license, basically the same as fill out if you're going to operate a television station, or radio station or something. And technically you had to have a license to use any wireless microphone in that band. This was also limited to just a small class of users. You had to be a broadcaster or a radio or television or motion picture producer or production company. Certain educational broadcast operations and cable television operators could apply for licenses for the wireless microphones. But not churches, not schools, not theme parks, not Broadway shows, not government offices, not corporate conference centers, not rock and roll guitar players or aerobic dance instructors or karaoke bars. None of those people are in that short list of eligible users. But because the licensing was complex and expensive and also unenforced by the FCC, very few people bothered to ever license these microphones. In fact, the FCC has on file approximately 950 licenses for wireless microphones in the United States of America. We suspect there are more than 950 wireless microphones in the United States of America, but you couldn't prove it by the FCC records. This was a two-edged sword, though. On the one hand, the FCC could ignore us safely because there has never even been an anecdotal incident of a wireless microphone interfering with a broadcast operation, which was the whole point of the licensing. But by the same token, when it came time to try to appeal to the FCC for some protection in the midst of all of this shuffling around, they could say, well, how many of you are there? What's the big deal? You know, and then as well, it's like a million. Oh, okay. So by a long process of lobbying and filing briefs with the FCC and so forth, the FCC finally decided to issue a blanket re-certification, not re-certification, licensing requirement for wireless microphones, which is that there is no license required if the power level that you're operating is 50 milliwatts or less. So they reclassified all wireless mics at 50 milliwatts or less as Part 15 unlicensed consumer-type devices that do not require a license, like your Wi-Fi thing, your cordless telephone, all the rest of that stuff. So now there is no requirement to have a license in the broadcast band if you're at 50 milliwatts or less. But this is not necessarily a good thing for us because it puts us in the same category with any sort of consumer wireless unlicensed thing, and there are movements afoot to put such things into the broadcast band, and that's what we'll look at here now. This you can still get a license for a wireless mic, particularly if you can operate above 50 milliwatts, but right now it's still this very small user group that can theoretically get one. But there's a strong sign that the FCC will expand that eligible user group to include larger users like big churches and theme parks and Broadway theaters and conference centers and things like that. Still not the aerobic dance instructors and the rock and roll guitar players, but larger professional users. But that has not been done yet. So our only real restriction is you got to stay under 50 milliwatts. If you have a license, you can actually transmit it up to 250 milliwatts. Not something we typically recommend, but if you need to do that, you could get a license for that. Still, the FCC is not claim that they're going to do any enforcement of this, but this relieves them of having to talk to most people. These warnings have to be on all wireless stuff that's sold today. The timeline is all this stuff has happened. June 12th, everybody out of the pool, and there are rebates that manufacturers are running that I think most are ending at the end of June, so some incentive to move. So everything is still legal, yes. As long as it's standard 50 milliwatts, you don't need a license. But they're expanding eligibility, hopefully. And here's where we get into the stickiest part of this, these
white space devices. Let me go to. Anybody heard of white space devices or TVBDs as they're now known? All right. This is probably the biggest threat that we face in the foreseeable future. And this is basically a proposal to allow unlicensed consumer devices to operate in the open television channels, the same place that we're operating. White spaces are the unused television channels, and there's lots of them in most markets. The proposal calls for these things, which are of two categories, a fixed sort of high power thing and a portable low power thing. And the expectation is that these will be used for some sort of broadband access, because the people in Washington are worried that we're falling behind in broadband access, because we all need massive amounts of spectrum to watch YouTube or something, right? Of course, this gets the politicians all excited, and they've claimed, no, we need 600 megahertz of new spectrum in the next 4 years. Well, there isn't even 600 megahertz available anyway. They propose to add more things to the broadcast spectrum to do this, and of course, it's propelled by the computer companies, Microsoft, Google, Dell, HP, and also Motorola, who sense the opportunity to sell some gear, to sell a bunch of stuff and services. So there's some high stakes here in terms of the money involved. But the two categories, these fixed devices, up to 4 watts, they have certain restrictions. They can't operate adjacent to an active TV channel. But then the portable guys, which are of more concern to us because they could be anywhere, they can operate up to 100 milliwatts of power, although 40 milliwatts adjacent to TV channels. The nightmare scenario is that you're putting on a big concert down at the TD Center, and there's 1,000 people in the audience surfing the web on the same frequency that your lead singer is. This is a potential issue. These are the players, these are the guys, and these are the other guys, and blah, 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 except those guys. Yeah. Why are these slides still here? But the irony, of course, that we always appreciate is, you know, you got guys like Sergey Brin here, the Google guy, who loves using our wireless microphones, little realizing that if his plan goes into effect, none of this stuff will work anymore. And of course, we always appreciate when Bill uses our wireless microphones. So the FCC has made a ruling last November about how these things have to function in order to protect the operations of wireless microphones. It's a three-level protection scheme, protected TV channels, geolocation thing, and spectrum sensing. And just briefly, the protected TV channel depends on this limitation. The fixed devices, the high-power guys, can operate anywhere in the VHF or UHF spectrum. The portable handheld guys can only operate from TV channels 21 through 51. And if there is a TV channel in there and they're next to it, they have to be operating at the lower power. So here's the first level of protection that arises here. If there are television channels in the 14 through 20 range in your town, there can't be any white space devices next to them because the low power guys can't be there at all, and the high power guys can't operate next to a TV channel. So in this setup, this happens. A couple of public safety things here, a couple of TV channels. That means that the adjacent TV channels are protected. They're reserved. There can't be white space devices there. And the further protection for large cities, these cities that have some public safety operations here in the 14 through 20 range, you get two more protected TV channels, and those are the first available channel above TV 37 and below 37. So in this example, 37, the radio astronomy channel, there's a DTV 38, it's the next available one. Going north here is 39, so that's protected. And going south, 36 is occupied, so the next available one is 35. So in this case, 35 and 39 are off limits again to all white space devices. if there's public safety here. If there's public safety down here, you get these two extra channels up here. If there's no public safety down here, the only protected ones you get are adjacent to TV channels down here in the
court. So if there's no public safety, you know that there's going to be TV at 35 and 38?
No. This is a specific example. If I go to the next one here, this is Chicago. So the blue things are our current DTV stations. And 36 and 38 are two active TV channels. So the next available, meaning open, unused, not a TV channel, is 39 going this way. So that becomes protected. Going this way, it's 35.
This is an example of being in Chicago.
Right. Now, if we go to Boston.
Or Las Vegas.
Where's Boston? I have Boston in here somewhere. Unless I hid the slide. Excuse me. I hid the slide. That was dumb. Let's go back to there. Bing down. Okay. So. So here's a situation in Boston. You've got public safety on 14 and 16, yes? But these three, 18, 19, 20, as we saw on the spectrum analyzer, are occupied. But that means that 15 and 17 are protected, because no portable guys can be there, and the high-power guys can't operate next to the TV or public safety channels there. And because you've got public safety here, you get two more up here, which are, in this case, 38 and 36, because those are the first open TV channels above and below 37.
So they use channel 37 as sort of a place to work out from.
Yes, that's and that was literally a sure suggestion. They just took it wholesale as a convenient way to add some extra channels in these larger metro areas. So in smaller towns, for instance, Las Vegas, they luck out. They don't have any public safety here, but they do have a TV channel here, so these two are protected. But because they don't have public safety here, they don't get any extra protected channels up here. However, they've got a lot of open spectrum, so there's still plenty of places to play. And you know, different cities have different situations. So, the second level of protection is this so-called geolocation database thing. Now, this is it sounds good on paper, but it hasn't been implemented yet. It proposes a database that wireless microphones can register in. And when I say wireless mics, I mean wireless inner monitors and wireless intercom and all that stuff. Can register in, and you register your location, the frequencies that you're using, when you're using them, like Sunday mornings or Wednesday evenings or whatever. And any of these white space devices have to have a GPS built in so they know where they are, and the ability to look up a database by Wi-Fi or cable or something, not using the UHF frequencies. And so they turn on, oh, I'm here in Boston, and they look at the Boston database. These TV channels, these wireless mics, I've got to avoid all these frequencies. So that's good for the TV guys and for the people that are in the database. How do you get in the database? Unknown at this point. Also unknown whether it will be restricted to licensed users only, or the larger classification of the things that the FCC is working on. The Google guys want it strictly licensed guys and strictly the very narrow set of licensed guys. And that's because...
Suppose it can't update the database because it's not allowed to operate.
It's not allowed to operate if it can't find the database.
Really?
Yes.
That's the reason.
There's some serious restrictions on these things. And a 1 kilometer radius around the point of operation if any of these things are in there.
And the GPS.
Yeah, so, and the part of the problem, of course, is that by forcing these devices to have this capability, it's going to make them more expensive. And, you know, they'd like to sell these things for $50. Well, these are rapidly becoming iPhone-like things.
Yeah. When they require number of the receiver?
Radios. And, pardon?
When they require that location stuff of the receiver, not the friend.
Well, the thing you're holding.
I mean, the base station for the microphone itself might have the geolocation.
Well, we, that is wireless mic guys, don't have to do any of this stuff.
Except register that you're...
The white space device has to have a GPS in it so it knows where it is, it can look up the database, and our wireless mics are listed in the database and it avoids using those frequencies. That's the way the geolocation database is supposed to be.
I'm really impressed you guys are related.
Well, we spent a lot of money and time
lobbying
to protect wireless microphone operations, basically by convincing the FCC that not only are there more than 950 wireless microphones in the U.S., they actually serve a useful purpose. Every church service, every theater production, every school play, every theme park, every meeting that the FCC holds themselves relies on wireless microphones. They are ubiquitous. You can't do a sporting event or a musical production without wireless microphones anymore. We totally depend on these things. And so once we made this case, they were able to justify
this. Commercial businesses also have a stake in it.
Pardon?
Commercial companies also have a stake in this because I know the company I work for, which is not small, when the local division lead wanders around through all the facilities, he's doing wireless mic work within the facility.
Yes.
And so it isn't just the province of, say, the
not just
the
wars,
it's the dot-coms and other companies as well.
Exactly. But the
for-profit organization.
The reason they want to restrict the database is that if you make 1 kilometer rings around all the theaters in Manhattan, you can't use white space devices in Manhattan. This is not happy for them because there's a lot of people that live there. They'd love to sell these little boxes to them. So there is a very strong kind of ongoing movement on the part of white space's proponents to gut some of these requirements, and we'll see how this shakes out. The last bit, and this is the part that is probably most on the chopping block, is spectrum sensing. These things are supposed to do a listen before talk. That is, they scan their range. If there's anything on the air, their TV station or wireless mic that's not in the database, they have to avoid those frequencies. They have to rescan every minute, and they have to vacate the frequency within a couple of seconds when they find something. And they have to look at levels down at minus 114 dBm. That's way down. That's way, way down.
If you're going to get this sophisticated, why the hell don't you just go to spread spectrum systems?
Well, but that's their problem, not ours. So presently, spectrum operation is not legal within the broadcast band. And so this
why is
that? Pardon?
Why is that?
Because the FCC is afraid of it. They don't, if you can use it up around 2.4 gig and 5.6 gig and those unlicensed consumer bands, but you're not legally allowed to operate spec spectrum in the broadcast television band.
Because they don't understand.
It's a different animal to them. They don't understand what effect it may have on television operations or the primary users. So because these requirements are very, very stringent, and these guys are lobbying very, very hard and they've got a lot of money, the spectrum sensing requirement is very likely to disappear. But the protected channel thing will probably survive, and hopefully the database will survive in some fashion. Both of those will ensure that most large wireless mic operations can continue without too much trouble from these devices. Keep in mind, these things do not exist yet. They're not even close to existing. No product has gotten out of anybody's lab to show to the FCC. And because of these restrictions and other political issues, it's possible they may never come to market. Because it's kind of a solution for a problem that doesn't really exist yet. They've got a lot of plans, but no real compelling business model for these things.
So it's a solution in search of a problem.
Right. So, at the end of all the spectrum stuff, check your inventory, make sure there's not a lot of 700 megahertz stuff still floating around there. If it is, think about changing it out. Always take a look at the local TV channels to see what frequency bands are best. And going forward, you'll have to consider using a best practices approach to make sure that we can take the best advantage of remaining spectrum. In the event that these things come into existence, the places that you'd want to stick your wireless microphones would be in those reserve channels primarily, and a good wireless system, you could put 6 or 7 wireless mics into an open TV channel. The other reserve channels in the upper part in the larger towns. If there are open channels in 14 through 20, that's a good place to put them because there won't be any of the portable guys down there. Maybe the fixed guys will hopefully know where they are, we can work around them. And then finally, anything that's not occupied by a TV channel throughout the range. It's probably useful to think about putting wireless mics right next to a TV channel, because the high power guys have to stay out of there, and the portable guys have to operate at low power if they're adjacent to a TV channel. So we kind of work in the shadows of the television channels and get a little bit of protection from some of these guys. So these are just some concerns perhaps for the future, but again, these don't exist yet. I don't expect we'll see anything in this regard for 2 or maybe 3 years at this point because of these obstacles. Yes?
Is there any possibility that protected channels could become future DTV channels?
The question is, do we need to worry about more television channels coming here? The short answer is no, because given that only 15% of the population is watching terrestrial broadcast, the business model for putting up a full power television station is not attractive. However, there's been quite a lot of activity in low power television over the last few years, particularly foreign language stations serving local communities, Polish language stations and Spanish language stations and so forth. So while we don't expect there's going to be much change in the high power, full power station lists, you may see some more low power stuff coming out of here.
Are those all digital? Or?
They don't have to be digital at this point. Some are, many are not. I think they've got 5 years to change over.
I should throw away that old zoning TV.
No, don't throw it away yet. Don't throw it away.
Is there some discussion pending that even more terrestrial channels will disappear?
So the question is, we lost the top third of the spectrum in last June. Are we going to lose more of it? And it's entirely possible. Not soon, but some of you might dimly remember when UHF televisions used to tune up to TV 83. Okay, so what happened to TV channels 70 through 83? Well, that got lopped off back in the 1960s for what ultimately became the analog cell phone band, which was just above TV channel 69. And so now, 4 years later, they've chopped off another top third. And this all goes back to a huge pile of spectrum reserved for UHF television, expecting lots of TV stations to come out of there, never materialize. So with the digital transition, they're able to pack the remaining TV stations in a smaller chunk and sell off the top portion. There's clearly a lot of spectrum left. You could probably pack these things down even farther and sell off some more spectrum. But at this point, the broadcasters are going to be very, very resistant to giving up any more spectrum. They have just spent billions converting all of their operations to operate the DTV domain. And yet there are movements in some quarters to eliminate broadcast television entirely. Just, that's the end of it. Everybody gets on cable or satellite and no more broadcast television. This could very well happen in your lifetime, but probably not mine. Because the broadcasters are still a powerful group and they're not going to go down without a fight. So I would expect no more wholesale loss of UHF spectrum for at least another 10 years, more likely longer than that.
What's going to happen is people eventually replace television sets. The new sets all have new digital tuners.
Yes.
So they will be able to start receiving digital broadcasts without on the air stuff without special hardware.
Yes, they can already.
Or whatever, if they bought a new TV. Mm-hmm. And that's, I think, some of the thing that's going to happen as TV sets expire and people suddenly want to go to high def,
yeah,
or they want a different aspect ratio on their sets or want to hang one on the wall or whatever.
There has been an uptick in terrestrial broadcast watching because people who have bought digital televisions, if they bother to hook them up to their antenna, get a really nice
HD picture for free. And in fact, the over-the-air picture is actually better than what you'll get off of cable or satellite because it's not compressed. This is becoming a little bit more known to the general population who figured out they're not shackled to the satellite box or the cable box to get high-definition program.
We'll take a little bit of a break here. When we're talking about frequency coordination, the very first thing you want to do is avoid occupied TV channels. Good idea. These guys are transmitting a million watts, and we've got 10 milliwatts, so let's go to where there isn't a TV channel. And you can find the occupied TV channels by doing a scan, by going to various manufacturers' websites, by looking up the FCC database and so forth. This is an old scan from somewhere. That's an analog station. That's a DTV station. Oh, there you go, Boston Skyline. In a way, it is. So if you go to a typical manufacturer's website, you can put in a city name or a zip code and select some lookup radius. 50 miles is a typical default. If you're outdoors, you may have to worry about TV channels that are even 50 miles away. Indoors, perhaps 30, 40 miles, because the building provides some shielding, like this building, for example. So you stick that in. It'll give you a list of TV channels which are within that radius. It tells you how far away they are, whether the digital analog, these are all digital here in Boston. It also will note the public safety channels because you want to stay out of those guys. And this list is not rigorous. That is, it does not include the low power TV stations, only full power broadcast licenses. So in a particular corner of somewhere, there might be a low power thing two blocks away that could cause a problem. This list will not show that. It also doesn't really differentiate in terms of power. Some of these are million watt stations, some of them are 200 kilowatts. It treats them all the same in this, this setup. Once it gives you the list of TV channels, it'll also give you suggested frequencies to use for your wireless microphone. So in this case, if it was a Shure UHFR system like this thing, it would suggest if you're in, say, the H4 band, you could put up as many as 19 systems on the air at one time and put them all in group 6 and these various channels in group 6. Groups in most manufacturers' equipment are pre-calculated compatible sets of frequencies. So the normal way you'd set up a bunch of these things is to put them all group 6, group 6, 6, 6, 6, 6, 6, 6, and then just different channels, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, whatever, and that gives you a compatible set of frequencies without having to calculate anything. And these,
of course, are different.
Pardon? Different, right. And the groups and channels are of no relationship from one manufacturer to another. So Sennheiser is a different sort of thing, and AKG, but they'll all have a similar philosophy of creating these things. So it's perfectly fine to put all your gear in the same group and different channels within that group if you're within one frequency band only. If you're in multiple frequency bands, or you're using equipment from multiple manufacturers, things get a little trickier because the group and channel scheme breaks down. It doesn't consider interactions from other frequency bands or other manufacturers' stuff. So when you're using multiple systems, and of course we greatly encourage this, you have to satisfy two criteria. One is that any two frequencies have to be different by some amount. They can't share the same frequency or they'll interfere with each other. And number two, if there are more than two transmitters, there are interactions between transmitters that can create new frequencies called intermodulation products that can cause interference within your own gear. And so you need to be able to calculate those effects and work around them.
Those occur in the receiver, or do they occur in the transmitter?
The intermod products occur both in the transmitters and in the receivers, and we'll look at this in some detail here in a second. The minimum frequency spacing has to do with the selectivity of the receiver. The receiver has a series of filters, front-end filters, intermediate frequency filters, that allow it to look at a pretty narrow window to see the frequency it wants. A high-performance receiver may allow a minimum frequency spacing of only 400 kilohertz, or perhaps even less. a not-so-selective receiver, read cheaper receiver, may require frequency separation perhaps 1.5 megahertz. Clearly, the receiver that has the tighter selectivity would allow you to use more simultaneous systems in the same frequency range than one that requires much greater space. And this is why when somebody is contemplating using a multiple wireless system, the first question to ask is, what's the total that you're going to be using? And that means not just the total today, but you're going to add systems next year and the year after that. How big a rig are you going to get up to? And if it's 2, anything will work. If it's 6 or 8, most things will work. If it's 15 or 16, I'm going to have to get a little bit more selective set of equipment to do this. If it's 30 or 40 or 50, you have to buy the good stuff, or you'll never be able to put up that many channels in the same place at the same time. So that's kind of how you categorize the level of performance you're going to need based on the total number of systems you're going to try to put up at one time. The second thing that happens is this intermodulation product, which occurs when multiple transmitters are operating. And it's easier to demonstrate it than to talk about it. So let me go to one I set up here on the list. Yes? Yes, okay. All right. Now I've tuned the spectrum analyzer to a range of 10 megahertz from 530 megahertz to 540 megahertz, so 530 to 540. This is a 10 megahertz range. Each division is 1 megahertz. So I have a transmitter, which is set to 535 megahertz right in the middle of the screen. Okay, so I'll just put this guy up here somewhere. And my receive antenna is behind a post. Perhaps I should move that. Actually, you know what? Leave that there, and I'll just stick another antenna on here. There we go. Oh, that's better. Because now it's only 2 feet from the antenna. Okay. So there's one transmitter. And now I've got another transmitter here on the 536 megahertz. I'm actually going to put this thing back over here. So, these two transmitters are both operating at the same power level. Oops, sorry, wrong way. I'm going to bump that. And they're 1 megahertz apart, so they're not going to interfere with each other. This equipment could operate as close as about 350 kilohertz, and they won't talk to each other. So these are perfectly compatible frequencies. But if I get them into some proximity with each other, I get some other stuff happening. Guys over here.
It's interesting. Before you even put them together, you could see a small spike in both those areas, depending upon where you walked.
Yes.
Them.
Yes.
So movement and interference and so forth also impacts it, obviously.
Yes. So these two transmitters, which are the tall things, one of them seems to be flaking a little bit here, are generating intermod products here and here, these two things. And what's going on in this case, mechanically, is that the signal from this transmitter, radiating in all directions, is picked up by the antenna on this transmitter, gets into the output stage, mixes with that, some nonlinear circuits in there, and generates some new frequencies. And likewise, the signal from this guy gets picked up by this guy, mixes in the output stage, and generates some more frequencies. So this thing and that thing are called third-order intermodulation products. The order of the intermodulation product is determined by the sum of the coefficients, the pieces that make it up.
And there's another one there on the extreme right.
And this is a fifth order product over here. And there's one buried down here. So you could calculate these intermod products using the formula of 2 times this frequency minus that frequency equals this frequency. And 2 times this frequency minus that frequency equals that frequency. But an easier way to do it is to note that whatever the interval is between the original 2 frequencies, the inner modules will appear at exactly that interval above and below these frequencies. So you get an equally spaced set of things. And these things are not an artist's conception. They're actual transmissions. These are real radio frequencies coming out of these 2 transmitters, besides their original frequencies. They're not causing a problem with each other, but if I inadvertently tune a receiver to either of those intermod frequencies, and if this is 535 and this is 536, what's that frequency? 537. Excellent.
That's why I like AES groups. They can multiply and add and subtract.
Bunch of geeks.
So we go to 537 on our receiver here, and sure enough, it lights up like a Christmas tree because it's picking up that frequency. Now, if I turn off either one of these transmitters, that thing will go away. Turn off the other one, same thing. Because that is the intermod product, not either of these transmitters by itself. Now, interestingly, if I hook up a microphone to one of these transmitters, I don't have an audio hookup to the PA, I apologize. But if I hook up a microphone to this and I talk into this guy, you'll see green LEDs going up and down there, indicating there's audio going through there. What you don't actually see, let's see, which one is this? This is 5. I'm plugged into the 535. 535. This 535 is the one I'm plugged into the microphone with. So if I unplug it from there, stick it into the 536, and talk into it, testing one, two. There's audio there. It's really loud, though, isn't it?
Wow.
Louder than the other one. But clearly, the audio that shows up there is coming from both transmitters. If there's audio in either one of these or both, it will show up on the intermod product. And the thing to note here is that the level of this thing is louder, actually, than the on-channel signal would be. And that's because the effective deviation of the FM signal, that is how wide it changes its frequency when you modulate it, is proportional to how loud the audio is. So if I multiply 2 FM signals together, which is part of the intermod process, the effective deviation gets much greater. Since deviation is proportional to loudness, the signal that I'm going to hear, the audio signal, is going to be louder and typically distorted compared to the on-channel signal. Now, this is a problem, because if you've got this receiver live to the sound system, faders up, mutes off, and I just start turning on transmitters, that receiver is not only going to light up like a Christmas tree, it's going to produce audio in your sound system that's going to be loud, distorted. Typically, the system will go into feedback, and the chaser will be out of the room, and you'll be very unhappy.
You're fired.
And you might be fired. So the point of the exercise here is not only to consider these intermod products, because they are real things, but also you really shouldn't operate wireless microphone receivers live to the sound system unless their transmitters are turned on. Unless you've calculated a very robust set of frequencies that keeps very far away from these intermod products. Unfortunately, many of our church friends are fond of operating their sound systems with all the receivers on all the time, live to the sound system, faders up, mutes off, they don't understand mute buttons. And then they just start turning on transmitters randomly. And all kind of bad things happen.
Even looking at this, if you turn another transmitter on, you would get even more excitement because then you'd start getting a modulation with the harmonic in modulation.
I paid this guy to make that observation. So I turn on a third transmitter. Now, this transmitter is 1.5 megahertz below the 535. So this is actually at 533.5. This is a compatible frequency. There is no intermod product where this thing comes up.
There's a couple of small ones to the but if, left.
But. Right, but if I put this thing close to these guys, things look messy. However, this is three perfectly compatible frequencies. These are not interfering with each other. They're not causing any problem with each other.
But
I've got a whole bunch of frequencies occupied, so when I'm going to put up my fourth system, you know, I say, okay, where do I put the fourth frequency? You can't do that by inspection.
Now, this is a consequence of having acted out with circuits without, like, L's and C's.
Nonlinear circuits.
Yeah, right.
Nonlinear circuits.
So back in the day, if they actually had two transmitter antenna circuits, this would be
a problem. Oh, no. Any two transmitters, unless they're equipped with like microwave isolator filters on them, will exhibit this problem.
Well, that's what I meant. If you had a filter.
Yes. If you have an isolator filter on it, you could reduce the amount of energy getting back into the transmitter from the outside source.
But then it would be so large.
Wireless mics generally aren't equipped with those because they're big and expensive. So, and again, this is not a problem because I can calculate all these things and come up with more frequencies that don't land on these things and don't create new problems. But one other thing that I want to...
That's another app for your iPhone.
If I turn off the middle transmitter, so now I've got this one at 536 and the one at 533.5, as expected, this new interval tells me where my intermodified should be. So even if they're 5 megahertz apart or 10 megahertz apart, 30 megahertz apart, they'll create intermods those distances apart. So this is not confined only to the vicinity of the transmitters that you need to.
How close do they have to be physically to do that?
Well, that's a good question.
It's a display play.
I'll turn off number 3. Yeah. And notice this guy's lit up pretty well because I'm pretty close to these things. So let's say if I put this guy over here, and I'll move this guy over here. Well, look at that. It's still lit up. And that's because at this distance, although you can see maybe a little bit of something happening there, the intermod product is not being produced in the transmitters. They're far enough apart from each other that the interaction is weak enough. That's not where the intermod product is going. Clearly the thing is lighting up. The intermod product is occurring in the receiver. In the mixer circuit of the receiver, which is a nonlinear device by definition, these two products are mixing and generating the intermod product in the receiver itself. So this intermod production occurs in hardware, not out in the air. It occurs either in the transmitters or in the receivers, or both, depending on their relative distances. So it's not enough that these things are 20 feet apart from each other. That thing's still going to light up and produce sound.
Maybe since we're audio guys and not radio guys, we should say they're beating and not and mixing in the audio world is linear.
Mixing in the audio world is linear.
And
so they're beating.
The world is
they're
beating out. Against each other.
That is a way to
what must get really interesting is if you have two separate adjacent theaters running shows in like Broadway, and they're all using wireless microphones. This must turn into an absolute horror show.
They have to coordinate with adjacent theaters to some extent. Now, the one other bit I'm going to do here when I've got this stuff on, these are operating at 10 milliwatts. I'm going to bump the power on these guys to 100 milliwatts. Okay, so this one's at 100 milliwatts now. And I'll put this one at 100 milliwatts. Okay, and now I'll put these guys next to each other. This is not good. Again, these are not interfering with each other. These are two perfectly happy transmitters. They are having a good time. But because of the high power, I've made the power 10 times higher. And because the intermod power is proportional to the square of the power of the devices that are producing it, by running that thing up 10 times, that's 20 dB. So it causes the intermod power to go up by 20 dBm. And that they're starting to get close to the power level of the actual transmitters. This is a really big problem. And now I not only have to worry about my third order products, these guys, but I've got fifth order, seventh order, ninth order, 11th order, 13th order, whole bunch of stuff that I now have to avoid.
This is also costing you RF.
Pardon?
I mean, this is costing you RF.
Absolutely. Well, it's not costing me power. It's not costing me power. It's costing me available spectrum. Because if I'm going to put up 40 channels of wireless,
I realize that.
Yeah.
But the fact that something is producing these spikes means power is coming from somewhere. It's coming from your output stage.
Yes, but it's
it may be insignificant, but it's
not going to drive the batteries on. It's not really consuming extra power from the batteries, really. These extra spikes here are going to eat up a lot of spectrum, so if I want to operate at high power, I can only operate a handful of systems simultaneously.
What's also interesting is to watch you as you move, it's changing the amplitudes all over the place.
Right.
And of course, the next time a state cruiser goes by and he fires up his radio, you're going to add to the chaos.
Potentially, although they're not anywhere near where we are. So this is my little InterMod demo. So then the question becomes, how do we get around this? How do we work with this? Because this is normal behavior of these systems. And that's where frequency coordination programs come into effect. This is just slides in case the spectrum analyzer is gone. We talked about compatible groups and channels. By using compatible groups and channels, we can get a coordinated set of frequencies that takes into account the InterMods. It's already calculated to be that way. But we can't do this with multiple frequency bands or multiple manufacturers' equipment. When we're getting into that situation, we need to go to a custom calculated frequency set. And for that, we use something like a program like a wireless workbench program. And just briefly, we'll look at this process. Do I have my program running here? The answer is yes. Okay. All right. This is the user interface that shows up for this particular software called Wireless Workbench. The software does two things. The first thing, it controls and monitors a certain type of wireless receiver. But the other thing that it does is function as a completely generalized frequency coordination program without regard to being hooked up to any particular hardware. So I'm hooked up to this one receiver just as an example of how I can integrate scanning. But it's not necessary to have a Shure receiver or any receiver whatsoever to utilize this program to calculate compatible sets of frequencies. And I'll just go through a quick example. We go into compatibility mode. We're going to do synthesis, where we're going to calculate a new set of frequencies for a bunch of gear that we're going to try to use on some show here. You can also analyze frequencies and do some other things with the program, but this is illustrative of how it works. In this case, it happens to know that I'm hooked up to one particular receiver, so it lists it there, and it's asking me, do I want a new frequency for this receiver? And I'm going to say yes, so I'll leave that checked. I'm going to leave one of these transmitters on at 536, I guess, 535. And I'm going to turn on, this is within the range, I think. I'll turn this guy on. This is a different type of transmitter. It's operating at some other frequency that might be in that range. Is it? I think so. Okay. In fact, I'll just do the scan and we'll see what happens. So it's going to offer to do a scan with this receiver. It can only do a scan in the frequency range of the receiver, which is a 60 megahertz chunk. Other receivers could be hooked up to this. It could scan in those other bands as well. Or if you did want to do a scan, there are devices available from a company called Win Radio, an Australian computer-controlled scanner company. And there are hooks in this program that will allow Win Radio to be used as an external scanner. So you don't have to have Shure equipment to do this. If you do want to scan, this Win Radio device can accomplish the same thing. but we'll use this thing right now. It's going to scan the 60 megahertz range, and it's going to find some stuff, and I've got some pretty heavy stuff going on here. Oh, that's because it's running at 100. Ah, all right, well, I'll have to undo this. An issue here, you see all these tall things? I'm actually picking up some intermod stuff between this 100 milliwatt transmitter, should have ducked it down, and this transmitter over here, which is running at 10 milliwatts. I didn't really want to do that. There's a DTV station and another DTV station. Because this is TV channels 14 through 23, I guess. No, not that. I'm sorry, H4 band. Let me back up a bit here. I need to. H4, yes. Ah, see, I'm causing more problems than I want to here. This is the spectrum analyzer picture of the same frequency range we're tuning. And these two things are due to too much stuff on here. So I'm going to turn this guy off and just leave this one transmitter running. I'll just leave that guy there. And that's probably in the middle of, there's actually the TV station there. But it's weak. I can overpower it here, so I'll just kind of further away. I have to get the antennas here and out of there.
It is important not to overload your scanner when you're doing this sort of thing. Because if you do, you get all kinds of spurious junk.
That will throw off the results, exactly. So if we go back to the, let me redo the scan here. And this will erase most of that junk. So keep in mind, this is scanning 60 megahertz range from 518 to 578. There's the transmitter that's over there. And some little junk on either side of it. And then it'll pick up these two TV stations, which are actually 30 and 31. Takes about 60 seconds to do a scan in this much range, but it allows the computer program to integrate this data to calculate compatible frequencies that avoid stuff that it finds during the scan. So that's a couple of TV channels in that thing. So it picks up TV 30 and 31, just for comparison. This is our spectrum analyzer picture of it. There's my transmitter, and there's the two TV channels down there. And so it's going to avoid putting stuff into these two TV channels. If you are not on site or you can't do a scan, but you still want to take the TV channels into account, you can put a zip code in. Anybody know a zip code around here?
02467.
02467? So we'll put 02467 in here. We'll scan out to 40 miles, let's say. There's a database within the program that you can update online. And this lists all the TV channels of interest within 40 miles of where we are. Notice that 30 and 31 are in this list, 3 miles away. We expect they show up, and they did. And in fact, they're already checked off in the list over here, these two guys. So we can put the rest of these in to the list, and now the subsequent calculations will avoid putting frequencies into any of these occupied TV channels. So you can do this by remote control. You can pick a zip code in Chicago or LA, and it'll avoid the TV channels there when it calculates frequencies. You can scan to a larger radius if you're outdoors, or a smaller radius if you're in some heavily constructed building.
Does this have some kind of an update capability?
Yes.
down the road if you want to update.
Yeah, if you're online and you go to the help thing, there's a check for updates, and it'll load a new TV database in there. We update it maybe every couple of months. It's not changing very much right now, but it includes public safety channels as well. Notice 14 and 16 public safety are checked off there. These are the things that it found on air. The strong thing there is this transmitter, 535.
So I'll identify that actually as a UHFR because I know what it was. This is a weak signal. It's called an intermod because it doesn't know what it is. It's weak enough. I'm not concerned about it, so I'll uncheck it. This thing is probably part of a TV channel, but it wasn't strong enough to identify it that way. But I'll leave it checked so it'll avoid putting something there, and I'll just leave it as generic. So the top frequency is the one that it found in the scan. This is a generic thing, is there's other little bit that it found there. Now it will proceed, but I could add other frequencies to this page of equipment that was going to be used at the venue, but was either outside my scanning range or was not turned on when I did the scan. Or somebody hands you a list of frequencies for Fenway Park. Here's the frequencies we use. Stay off of them. Okay. Type in the program. Now the program will avoid landing on those things and also calculate intermods using those things so you get a fully adequate set of frequencies. I won't add anything here. Summarizes the list of TV channels and so forth. No conflicts here. Sometimes when somebody hands you a list of frequencies and you type it in, it'll analyze them and say, whoa, intermod problem is here, you're in the middle of a TV channel there. That's okay. You can either go back and fix those frequencies if you want, or just ignore them. Because from this point forward, the program will not create any new problems. It won't fix the existing problems, but it won't create any new problems. So you're safe to continue, even if there's some existing problems, if you're not worried about fixing them. So here's where we put our wish list of stuff together. This is the one it wants to replace that's in the rack there. And we'll ask for 15 channels of UHFR in the G1 band, and 15 in the H4 band, and 15 more in the J5 band. These are each 60 megahertz
bands. These FCC jurisdictions of Johnson's spectrum.
Pardon?
Is the G1, H4, J5 stuff, is that FCC?
Those are Shure frequency bands.
Oh.
But you can, so if you're using Shure equipment in this list, the frequency bands for all of our equipment are already in there. I just picked the bands.
So that's still part of the groups and gens issue?
Well, except that not exactly. These G1 is a 60 megahertz band, H4 is another 60 megahertz band, but I am now at this point free to choose any frequency in that 60 megahertz range in 25 kilohertz step sizes. So it's like 14 or 2400 frequencies in there. So I've got lots of room to maneuver here. And you can add other things if you want to put in some PSM 700s, let's put three of those in the L2 band. And just to be egalitarian, we'll put in some Sennheiser IEM 300s. Turn down here somewhere. There they are. We'll put in five of those, and we'll put them in the put them in their B band.
I don't know if this is what Frank was asking. The labels H4, G1, you know, J5.
Yes.
Who are those labels?
Those are Shure specific labels.
There is no standard.
There's no standard.
So in other words, if some of the other manufacturer has a name for the blocks that they've outlined,
right,
they're going to be completely different.
Yes.
And there's no
specifically
no standards that you guys are going to force upon yourselves.
There's no industry wide standard.
Right. Here's an example.
Yeah, but that's what I was thinking you were thinking, Frank.
Yeah. Here's the example. what Sennheiser calls the B band for their Evolution G3 series and their IEN300s is 626 to 662 megahertz. That's what they call the B band. Our H4 band, which this receiver and these transmitters are in, covers 518 to 578 megahertz.
I'm just saying that in general. I'm not a practitioner, so I have no right to complain, but if I was, I'd become a little fascist about this. And I would talk to Roger Furness or somebody and say, AES ought to do something and impose it upon you guys. And
the reason you can't impose it is because the bands, number one, the bands are not of equal width. Some of our equipment has a 60 megahertz band, some has 24, some
standards
has 12.
Standards committees worry about those things.
Each manufacturer has his own internally standard way.
So you send your representative to the standards committee.
So, but what the reason I added the Sennheiser. The reason I added the Sennheiser product was to demonstrate that this program can handle products of any manufacturer.
Right. And right away came up with a completely different language, B underscore 626. Like, what the hell? How does that relate to L3?
It doesn't.
But you can just erase the whole letter concept and think in terms of frequency.
Yeah.
You can letter concepts just their band coordination easy for that.
Yeah.
But it's still so
is the question back
all the same.
Okay.
As I understand it, this is all arising because the transmitters don't have isolators in the output, so the receivers don't have a lot of selectivity.
Correct.
So how large are those isolators?
We're able to use isolators in the Japanese frequency bands. It allows us to jam 39 systems into 22 megahertz.
Yeah.
But the company that makes those little isolators can't make one of sufficient bandwidth at a lower frequency range that we can stick it into our transmitter.
Because it's a microwave company that's never been faced with it.
Right. They don't know what the hell we're doing with these things.
Okay.
In time, we should be able to improve the linearity of the transmitters and receivers to minimize the strength of the internet box, but probably not to eliminate them entirely. I'll offer this. This particular beast here, which is a transmitter as well, does have very linear output stages and generates very, very low levels of intermod compared to these transmitters.
Because it's physically bigger.
But it's a physically bigger thing. We've got a lot more room and more stuff.
Stick the right stuff in there.
You're right. If these systems were perfectly linear, we wouldn't be producing intermods at nearly these levels. But historically, they aren't. And the receivers, even in a high selectivity receiver, if the intermod product is on channel, no amount of filtering will eliminate it because it's right in the middle of that frequency. So the only way to kind of trick the receiver is to have such a narrow front end on it that the products that are producing the intermod don't make it into the receiver in the first place.
Because the related problem is that you're splattering into other bands.
Yes, because we decide that the band limit is at 647 megahertz, two transmitters over here are going to generate intermods over here.
Yeah.
And that's why when you use multiple bands, that simple band channel concept doesn't work anymore. You have to go to look at the whole picture at one time. A question there?
The program is still taking into account the 700 megahertz.
It doesn't actually care at this point. I could put 700 megahertz frequencies in there and it will calculate them just fine. It won't find any TV channels up there anymore. But it doesn't throw you out of 700 meg because this program is able to be used around the world. So it handles things up in the 800 megahertz band for Europe and other countries. Yeah, it's not. But I just threw the Sennheiser in there because we've characterized some other manufacturers' equipment and put their frequency bands and things in here so we can include them in the process. Because it's rare that you'd only have one type of gear or one manufacturer's gear on your show. So when you finish all this out and you go to the next page, it calculates potential frequencies. This is an iterative process. It goes through many thousands of calculations. it succeeded, but not with the PSM-700s or the Sennheisers. And keep in mind, I didn't pick these bands with any thought as to whether there's actually any spectrum there or not. I would do that for real. A way to improve the situation, if you hit the auto-prioritize button, it will move the unknown stuff and the least frequency agile stuff to the top of the list, because the program finds the stuff at the top of the list first and then gets the rest of it worked in around it. So PSM 700, which is actually not even as agile as the Sennheiser, so I'm going to move it up one more spot, only has 32 frequencies that it can tune to. The Sennheiser can tune about 1,400 frequencies, and the UHFRs can tune about 2,400 frequencies. So I put the least frequency agile stuff at the top, the most frequency agile stuff near the bottom, and that gives it a better chance to find things. So I'm going to make it run 1,000 passes here. And you can make it run 10,000 or 100,000 or a million passes if you think you can squeeze out one more frequency. And sometimes that works. You need 40 and you get 39. Okay, run a million passes and go to lunch and come back and maybe it found the full frequency.
From lunch tomorrow.
Exactly. Maybe lunch tomorrow. So we're okay with the 700s, but it cost us some UHFR things because those are require more frequency spacing. So if you're still trying to get those large numbers, you can alter the parameters of the devices that you're having trouble with to so more frequencies.
So it's less picky about overlap.
Yes. It allows channel-to-channel spacing to get closer, and it allows channel-to-intermap spacing to get closer, and it ignores some of the higher-order intermap times. So this may allow us to get more frequencies. There are many tricks that you can play with the program to kind of beat it into submission when you need frequency sets.
Now, when it finds these frequencies, how does it load it to the actual
device? So we've succeeded here.
Okay. All right.
Which is good. I never know when I do these things whether I got a spectrum or not, but we succeeded here. If we didn't succeed with this, we'd go back and change the other ones that are standard to more frequencies, which opens up some more space. Or in an extreme case, we just can't do it. We go back and throw out a couple of weak TV stations that we decide are not worth worrying about. That gives us some more 6 megahertz chunks to play with. So there's ways to manipulate the program to do this. And when you go to the next screen, it gives you the solutions. This is your show list. So here's the Sennheiser frequencies, and here's the PSM 700 frequencies, and then all those UHFR frequencies.
So you have to do that manually.
Well, not necessarily. You can save this as a list, and we'll print it out or export it so you can bring it back in later. If you happen to be hooked up to certain networked devices like this thing, and it shows over here on the right-hand side, if I hit auto, or I can do it manually, it'll pull frequencies off the list and stick them into the receivers automatically. So when I hit the next button here, it will do its little light show and dump the first frequency in the H4 band that it found into that.
And for the Sennheiser, you do that manually.
And Sennheiser's program does a similar thing, but of course, our gear can't program Sennheiser
right,
here
course,
or vice versa. Someday, maybe. But the point is, it is possible with this software to calculate compatible sets of frequencies for any type of radio equipment in these ranges, if you know the parameters of that equipment, and come up with a fairly reliable set of frequencies to use for your event or your show in this fashion. And this program is a free software that works on both a Mac and PC platforms. And we update it on a regular basis, so you're certainly welcome to have at it sometime if you're interested. Was there a question in there?
I was just going to ask how much it was and where I could get it.
Ah! It's free and you can get it online somewhere. So as a quick example of a coordination thing that we did here in Boston a few years ago, blah. The Rolling Stones at Fenway Park. Yes. So everybody knows what Fenway Park looks like. If you're at the show, there's a lighting area up front and a sound thing over here. The B stage slides out to this platform from the main stage. There's this is the view from at the end of the B stage run. These big trusses above on the stage, they have monitor equipment pointing down onto it. And this shows the B stage, which actually rolls out in the middle of the show to the end of that runway and then plops down at the end, and then they can walk off that platform. So the tricky part of the wireless in this show is that all the instruments are wireless. There's wireless vocal microphones and some ears, but they have to be able to function at the main stage and also at the B stage, which is 150 feet out. So there's several sets of antennas. There's a set of antennas out in the sound booth out in the field to pick them up when they're at the B stage, and then more antennas on stage to pick them up when they're back there. So there's several sets of antennas to accomplish this. Standard U2s, now this is 2005, so they were still using a combination of 700 megahertz stuff and lower band stuff. The main vocal microphones and the receivers for that. All of the guitar players have many, many guitars back there in these big cases, but each player only used two transmitters at a time, and they had multiples, and they switched the straps and the packs around, so they always had two ready to go and then two spares, but only two frequencies per player for the instruments. So this is Keith's rig, and they were using paddle antennas on tops of the amp racks, because the stage is almost 200 feet wide, so they had to be able to cover quite a throw when the players were away from the center of the stage. This is the back side of it, so receivers down here. Then the B stage, this rolling platform, was the regular drum riser with extra amplifiers bolted to the side of it, actually attached with the bungee straps. And additional microphones and additional wireless systems back here.
I like that high class oriental.
Yes. So these amplifiers went out along with the drum riser and this B stage rollout. And the band would stand in there and this whole thing. Wouldn't they be playing while they went out to the B stage position? So this is some close up to the. So Ronnie had his rig. This is his stuff. And this is Mick Jagger's amplifier down here. Same sort of antenna rigs for these guys. Actually, these antennas are for. The wireless mic hookups, there's this is actually one of Keith's antennas and one of Ronnie's antennas, and there's a similar pair on the other side. And the transmitter's just strapped into these guys, just A and B for each of the two frequencies. It's Ronnie's rig, same deal, the receiver's back there, and his amps on the other side of the drum riser, and they had truckloads of these beautiful old Fender Tweed amplifiers. They must have had $1 million worth of old amplifiers and guitars in this tour. An amazing collection of stuff. You know, one goes down during sound check. Oh, this one's making a lot of noise. No problem. 10 minutes later, it's a brand new 50-year-old amplifier. Stuck right there where the other one was. Works like a charm. I just had the receivers for the B stage just plunked down behind the amplifiers. The bass rig, similar situation. His transmitters, receiver back there. And this is the B stage bass rig, another SVT parked next to the drum riser with another receiver and rig on it. So the whole thing had to slide along. Now this is Monitor World stage right. And this guy controlled the wireless microphones for the backup singers and the ear monitors for the backup singers. So this is all Sennheiser IM300s, and then these are the backup singers' wireless microphones up here. This is a Q receiver, so you listen to the ears. So that's the back vocals. Now this, they had an opening act on this show. This is the opening show. 2005, or two-night thing. And the opening act was the Black Eyed Peas. They arrived about an hour before showtime. No sound check. And they carted in a rack of wireless receivers that were our UHFR stuff, which they'd apparently gotten in L.A. on a trial basis, because the stuff hadn't actually been released at this point. And they brought it with them from L.A., parked it over in Monitor World, stage right, and turned it on. And I'm back there, and, oh, where'd this come from? Oh, that's cool. And they're all lit up like Christmas trees, although no transmitters are on, no air transmitters, because they brought this rig from L.A., where they're using it on local L.A. frequencies. And now we're outdoors in downtown Boston. And I said, well, what about frequencies? Well, these always worked before. So things got interesting at that point. So this was Boston circa 2005, all this stuff on the air. This is what we were looking at Fenway that week. Still, a fair number of open TV channels here. Okay, and we can still use this stuff up here, because that was okay back then. So today you have actually about the same amount of open TV channels, but they're rearranged from back then. So here's the deal. We needed four channels up in the UA band for these vocals, five more for the back vocals in the UB band, guitars for Keith, Ronnie, mixed guitars, bass guitars, his ears, back vocal ears, some more back vocal ears, and then the opening act. And the problem is that the H4 band of the opening act and the H3 band of these ears and the A band of the Sennheiser ears completely overlap. Way too much junk in this range. It's not the way we would specify this if we were ordering up gear for that show in that town. But that's what we had. So this is where the band planning thing comes in. This is what you have to go through on a big show like this. Easy enough to stick the vocals here, ears here, some vocals here. Keith's guitar is sticked in there. That's no problem. Ronnie's guitar is in here. But all this junk is down in these few channels. So we had to stick the Black Eyed Peas vocal microphones on these same guitar channels down here. But there was not time to re-coordinate a set of frequencies an hour before showtime. So all we could do was shut off the Stones guitar transmitters and put the Black Eyed Peas vocal mics on those same frequencies, because those are already recorded. Sounds simple, but politically that's a difficult thing to do.
And you have to fire it up
with an outfit like that an hour before showtime. But fortunately, we had somehow gained the trust of their backline guys. Said, here, we just need to turn these ones off, and the opening act can do their thing, and then they'll turn those off, turn these back, and everything will be fine, right? Okay. And we were able to get away with it. And the show was fine. There were no problems here. But this is an example of poor band planning, but not uncommon. These guys do not carry an RF coordinator with them. They carry a crew of 200 people, plus an additional 200 people in each town that they get to, but they do not carry an RF coordinator. And each of the three people that are working with RF, Monitor World, Stage Right, Monitor World, Stage Left, and the backline guys, kind of operate in their own little private Idahos. They don't really talk to each other very much. It's like, you know, we'll do here, and we'll do there. And they kind of get away. And it's not uncommon. I think today they're more inclined to carry RF coordinators, especially because the spectrum is a lot more congested. But so ultimately, you stick these things in their individual TV channels. And the trick is you don't want to put high-power things like the ear monitor transmitters, which are 100 milliwatt devices, into the same frequency bands as the wireless mics, which are 10 milliwatts. So you stick the ears here, mics here, some more ears here, some mics here, intercoms over here if you're dealing with that. And that allows you to get away with some close spacing after about these
wildly different power levels and things. So this worked because we were able to switch out these instrument frequencies for the vocal microphones.
So the ears are high power, basically.
The ears are almost all 100 milliwatt devices.
That's because they can, because they nailed down.
Because the ears are problematic because they're non-diversity receivers, so multi-path is an issue. So you tend to want to put more power out. But the guitars and the mics and stuff are all running at just 10 mils. And that's fine. They have high gain antennas, so we're good there. Yes?
Those high power ears still a problem with the licensing now?
Technically, yes. If you've got 100 milliwatt ears, to be legal, you should put a 3 dB pad on the antenna output, which cuts the power in half to 50 milliwatts. Is anybody going to check you down? Yeah, I'm sure everyone will do that. Anybody check on that? Probably not. But technically, this particular device is switchable for 10, 50, or 100. So you can change it on the fly. Where are we time-wise here? Can I do a few minutes on antennas before we throw me out of here? Okay. Every presentation needs at least one equation, and here it is. It's the wave equation. You've all seen it. Sound waves, light waves, all the same stuff. But for light waves, C is the speed of light, not the speed of sound. So when you plug that in, this gives our wavelength relationship for VHF and UHF waves. So the high-end UHF wavelength, about a third of a meter or so, a foot and a half or so. In the VHF range, 200 megahertz, so it's about 5 feet is the wavelength. You can see the radio wave. And of course, this relates to the antenna size and affects propagation of the waves to some extent. So for antennas, the higher the frequency, shorter the wavelength, the smaller the antenna. We deal with omnidirectional antennas and unidirectional antennas. The omnidirectional antennas, like these whip antennas like this, it's a center-fed dipole antenna. And the antenna that's up there on that stand behind the pole is also a half-wave antenna. It's this thing. But it's, by virtue of its larger diameter, it covers a wider frequency range, about 500 megahertz versus about 60 megahertz for one of these guys. And you want to have the antenna matched to the frequency range of your receiver to get the best efficiency. But just a quick look at the omnis, there are half-wave antennas like this with a upper and lower dipole element. And then there are quarter-wave antennas that are just half the length of this, and you sometimes see those stuck on the receivers. Quarter-waves are okay as long as they're mounted to some ground plane, which would be the receiver chassis or the ground plane in the PC board or something. But without a ground plane, they don't work very well. And you really have to use a half-wave antenna like this. So for remote mounting, half-wave antennas, not the quarter-wave guys, because these don't require a ground plane. From a pickup pattern standpoint, this is a side view of that half-wave wideband antenna there. This shows the expected omnidirectional pattern in the plane around the antenna. So it's equally sensitive in all directions that way. But if you look at the side view of this thing here, you see that the maximum sensitivity is perpendicular to the antenna. And as the incident angle arrives higher, the sensitivity decreases. So along the axis of the antenna, there's so when you're aiming an antenna at the source, and I get this.
That's got nothing to do with polarization.
It doesn't have anything to do with polarization yet. So if you're the transmitter out there, this is not aimed at you. This is aimed at you. Broadside to you is aimed at you. And this is a very common problem with our customers. They think this is aiming the antennas at the stage. But of course, that's picking up from over there, not out there. So it's not intuitive, but it's the way they work. If you look at directional antennas like the log periodic type, I don't have one with me, but these are a series of dipole antennas of different lengths arranged in a logarithmic distance relationship from
back to front.
Like a miniaturized analog TV.
And it's very much like a wideband television antenna.
Yeah.
But because it's confined to the UHF range, it's only about this long. And as you might guess, the dipoles at the rear of the antenna are active at the lower UHF frequencies, and the dipoles at the front are active at the higher frequencies. And in intermediate frequencies, the center of the antenna is active, but the other elements contribute. The ones behind the active region act as reflectors, and the ones
rain
effectively. It also can provide some rejection of interfering signals that are arriving from behind the antenna. So if you're outdoors doing a gig and you know where the television transmitters are, hopefully if the antennas are in the mixed position, the TV antennas are behind you and the stage is in front of you. Mm-hmm. So I can pick up the stage with enhanced sensitivity and reject the television towers behind me. If the TV channels are behind the stage, these are not good because they'll amplify the interfering stuff along with the desired stuff. And in that case, you might want to put the antennas off to the side, kind of aimed across, or some way to take advantage of that polar band. Yes?
If your receiver is within a certain frequency range and you get a standard half-wave antenna, which is going to cover that range, what is the advantage of this one?
None.
Okay.
That antenna, as cool as it looks, its only advantage is that it covers a 500 megahertz frequency range instead of about 60 megahertz, which one of these covers. So that antenna is useful if I've got a rack full of receivers in multiple frequency bands. Then that antenna will give me the same sensitivity throughout that radio frequency range. If my receivers are only in one 60 megahertz range, perfectly good, exactly equivalent performance.
Do you need a dipole for every 60 megahertz band?
Well,
a separate model. You have to like whip out another, depending on what 60 megahertz band, you whip out another one of those and attach it to the PSC connector.
Right.
Okay.
So typically the small whips like this have about a 60 megahertz
band. You travel around with a case of, you know.
Well, whatever your receivers,
or you get one of those.
Yeah, one of those covers a host of these.
Okay.
And that's why those are typically what you carry if you're using multiple frequency bands.
You want to follow with an amplifier.
Well, before we go there, let me go one other place. The vertical coverage angle of this is only about 60 degrees. So about 120 wide, 60 degrees vertical. So it's kind of like a short throw horn, really. An antenna that is a little different is the helical antenna. You occasionally see these things. This has a much narrower coverage angle, about 60 degrees instead of 120, but it's a conical pattern, so it's symmetric in the horizontal vertical plane. But it has more forward gain, about maybe 10 dB of forward gain. So like a long throw horn, and it's effectively concentrating the energy in a smaller area, so I get more gain in that particular direction. So these are useful for increased range, perhaps, because they have more gain. Or if I'm trying to reject interfering signals that are coming from closer in, that tighter pattern will reject some of that. Either of these antennas, that is the helical or a log periodic antenna, or the half waves for that matter, are reciprocal antennas. That is, they can be used as transmit antennas or receive antennas with the same result, same polar pattern, same gain, and so forth. So the only one that can't be used in a reciprocal manner are the log periodic antennas that have an amplifier attached to them. That amplifier is strictly to amplify incoming signals. It can't pass signals going the other way. But if it's a passive antenna, it's completely reciprocal in its function. The one thing, and here's where we get to the polarization question, is what happens if I have antennas oriented in different directions? If I go back to, I'll go here because this is a good place to put it. Let me get that antenna down here. I'll put this guy here. Stand up vertically.
plug it into our analyzer. And go back to our quest. Okay. Which is running?
That's one. Okay.
And the transmitters are not here.
Too much sensitivity. Let me just lower the sensitivity a little bit. Below the poor thing.
Okay. So, the polarization angle of a radio wave is generally parallel to the radiating element that produces it. So I have a vertically oriented, this is a quarter wave antenna, and the transmitter body functions as a counterpoise for this thing. So this is going to generate a vertically polarized radio wave, meaning that the electric field is oriented in this direction, and the magnetic field is oriented perpendicular to it. We don't really care about the magnetic field, but the orientation of the electric field is, it determines what the polarization angle is. So if I have a vertically oriented transmit antenna and a vertically oriented receive antenna, I should get the maximum coupling because the receive antenna is going to be most sensitive to the signal coming in at its polarization angle. So if I have this thing like this, but then I turn it 90 degrees, standing in a hole here, get out of the hole, I got multipath going on here. But if I stand not in a hole, and I turn this thing 90 degrees, notice that the signal level drops off, maybe 10, 12 dB, it depends to some extent. And this is due to the polarization angle difference between the transmitting radio wave and the receive antenna orientation. And this is normal behavior of polarized antennas like this. And so any dipole or quarter wave antennas will exhibit this this behavior.
A helical antenna wouldn't do that, right?
Pardon?
But you had a helical
but
antenna.
But a helical antenna does not have a preferred polarization angle. I don't have an example here, but the helical antenna does not really care about the orientation of the incoming radio wave, and when it produces a radio wave, a dipole antenna does not really care about the orientation relative to that wave. There is about a 3 dB loss in the ultimate signal level transmitted from a helical antenna compared to a dipole antenna of the same gain, but it doesn't vary with polarization. So there's a net reduction in the amount of fluctuation that you see when you use a helical antenna. Typically, you see the helical is used more often as transmit antennas for in-ear monitor systems because the in-ear monitor receiver, this thing, is a non-diversity device. It only has one antenna. So it's going to have polarization angle issues. So if I hit it with a circularly polarized wave, it doesn't really care which way the thing is oriented. I'll get a more consistent bubble. So that's just something to keep in mind. And it accounts for the suggestion there that if you're using diversity antennas, two antennas, instead of having them both vertical, you can have one vertical and one horizontal, or like this. If there's a 90 degree angle between the antennas, the philosophy is you're kind of splitting the difference in the polarization. I'm not going to be worse than 45 degrees off axis to one or the other of these things. So that's where the rabbit ear suggestion comes from. It's not a big deal, but it's one of some small compromises that people make sometimes that can ultimately result in unreliable operation. It is rare, and I need to stress this, it is rare that a single mistake in a wireless setup brings the whole enterprise down. It's usually a combination of small mistakes, small compromises that are made that eventually add up to a loss of signal in some case. So if we are aware of the choices and compromises at each stage, we can minimize the total losses that are going to occur. So this is a suggestion for diversity antennas. For diversity antennas, we're relying on the fact that the radio field is different at two different points in space. So if I have a multipath dropout here, I won't have a multipath dropout simultaneously over here. And here means, ideally, a wavelength apart or farther. A quarter wave would be the minimum spacing for some diversity. If you can get them out to about a wavelength apart, foot and a half or so, you're mathematically at maximum decorrelation at that point. But you can certainly put them farther apart. For instance, if they're this far apart and the antenna is in front of a post, by all means, move it to the other side of the post. So we've got a good strategic look at the coverage area. Some poor placement examples. The antennas are on the back of the receiver. Inside a solid steel rack, it has a steel front door and a steel back door, and the complaint was, the range is only 10 feet. And I said, that's pretty good. Considering the antennas are inside of a solid steel box, I was more polite.
It's called a Faraday cage.
Yeah, a Faraday cage. So, reluctantly, they agreed to take the antennas out of the steel box and put them up on the wall somewhere, and then the range was like 200 feet. And so, but it's not intuitive. Many, you can't see radio waves, you can't feel them, and you know, sound waves kind of get out of the box. Well, why can't the radio waves? Well, it's a different thing. It's not intuitive. So here's a great example from a place in Houston we were a couple of years ago. They had the paddle antennas. They did the 90-degree thing.
Cage.
But they're in this metal cage to keep the basketballs off of the soundboard. It was a church basement, social hall, something or other. And I didn't go through it earlier, but the spacing of the cage is a couple inches square between those grids. Well,
just about right.
The radio waves are about this long, but the grid spacing is only that big. So to a radio wave that's larger than the grid spacing, it can't get through. This is what keeps microwaves inside the microwave oven, even though the light waves can get out through the little grid. So same thing applies here. Just because you can see through this obstacle doesn't mean the radio waves can get through. The light waves are really short, but radio waves are pretty long. So it worked, they got 50, 60 feet of range out of this, which is enough to get to the front of the room, and we appreciate they spent $600 on the active antennas. But if they just put these on top of this cage, they would have been done. It's just another example of the non-intuitive nature of radio wave propagation.
Or just put a board up there instead of having the cage.
Another way. So those are the antennas in the back, not a good place. And these antennas too close together. This is an important note, which is that the antennas need to be up high to get a good look into the coverage area because of the problem of the 180-pound sacks of seawater called humans. And those numbers get larger every year that I do this. We're tremendous absorbers of UHF radio energy. So we're looking at that thing over there, and I transmit it here. So if this thing's out in the open, life is good. But if I just move it close to me, I'm going to cause myself maybe 10, 12 dB just by proximity to the seawater here. If I put the thing behind me, this is worse, because now there's more seawater every year that has to go through. And if you further compromise things by holding the antenna behind a nice magnesium housing, and then you stick it back here, then things are even worse, you know. And then I stand a little multipath and all, and I'm gone. Okay. So any of these compromises you make with the antennas cost you signal level at the receiver. You would not hear any of this. The receiver is perfectly happy down to a signal level of about here. You wouldn't even see the meters start to go down until you were down about here. The meters are they're measuring up to here. They're pretty much at full strength, and you're about there. So when the meters start to dive, you know you're getting close. There's a problem there. So
But you won't hear anything. You won't hear any problem at all. You get right close to the noise floor, a little noise up happens, and the next thing, you're gone. Because you've dipped into the noise floor there. So anything you can do to keep the average level up, and these fluctuations, if I just kind of walk around this thing and tilt it at different angles and stand here and there, and you'll see occasionally, you get into a good spot, I missed one there, it'll just dive 20 or 30 dB if I get in the right spot there, somewhere in there. That's normal multipath fluctuation, 20 or 30 dB, very typical. If you were watching this during the show, you'd have a heart attack. You'd see your stuff going up and down, and you'd think, oh my, I'm going to lose it. You look at the receivers, they're all lit up. Oh, that looks okay. Oh, they're going up and down. That's normal. That's perfectly fine. But when it gets down to within about 10, 15 dB of noise floor, then is where you get into trouble. So anything, if you compromise this thing, so the average signal level is 20 dB above the noise floor, normal multipath dropouts will kill you. So you've got to keep the signal level up to something reasonable so you can afford these multipath fluctuations.
A number of years ago, there was an ADS meeting at the Mount Defunct Mushroom Music Theater, and I believe they were using Sennheiser body packs, mm-hmm. and they were literally in the small of the back of most of the dancers, because it was West Side Story, and they were running the feed up to a spirit mm-hmm. microphone mounted on the foreheads. And the coverage was actually quite good, I thought, in that the only real problem they kept having was the TNC connectors on the Sennheiser microphones would break. I had one go during the performance, as I recall.
But line of sight is your best philosophy here. If the transmit antennas can see the receive antennas, you're going to be in better shape than if there's some obstructions like humans or walls or set pieces. This is an example from some UK publication. Shows a body pack transmitter on the guy's back, typical actor thing, and measuring the field strength around this guy on a turntable. So when you're on the same side measuring here, it's good. As you get around to the other side of the guy, you get these deep nulls caused by absorption through this guy's body. Not enough to kill you unless you've made some other compromises.
Of course, if you go ahead and remote antennas around the circle.
If you put the antennas out here, then you don't have
that. That may have been what they did at the theater, because it was a theater in the round. Mm-hmm. So
the strategic antenna position can minimize it. Don't get too close to the receive antennas. 10, 12 feet is probably a good minimum, because if I get close to that, because of inverse square law, power level of the antenna goes up, and I start overloading the receiver, and I aggravate intermod problems in the receiver. And I can even desensitize the receiver. It loses sensitivity if I hit it too hard with excess radio energy. Keep antennas away from parallel metal surfaces, which includes other antennas. But perpendicular to a metal surface is no problem. This is a null point for the antenna. Cable, you can get high losses in coax cable, a thin RG58 like this stuff, almost 20 dB loss per 100 feet at UHF frequencies. That's fatal. If you have to use long cables, you need to go to a low loss cable, like an RG8 or RG213, something like that. If you have to run hundreds of feet of cable, which we do not recommend. If you do, you've got to use this moosey expensive cable. And those numbers are all published in the cable manufacturer. When you're kind of calculating the antenna and rig, maybe the antenna has some gain, maybe it has an amplifier, then there's loss in the cable. Another amplifier to make up for some of the loss, some more loss here. The net of all of that should be, should be no more than about plus or minus 5 dB net gain at the receiver compared to what the signal is at the antenna. So if you've got 10 dB of loss, you need to add at least 5 dB of gain. If you've got 30 dB of loss, you need to add at least 25 dB of gain. But if you've got 10 dB of loss, do not add 30 dB of gain, because you'll crush your receiver with the extra gain. So you have to balance those things out. You don't have to have symmetric antennas. That is, I can use an omni to uni, wideband, narrowband, helical, paddle, doesn't matter.
antenna signals aren't mixed. There's no requirement for symmetric cable lengths or antenna types or any of that
stuff. How are the signals then when you have a multi-antenna for, like a circular thing, you have multiple antennas for the same to cover all angles?
If we've got multiple sets of antennas, a slightly different situation applies, but still...
You're not mixing the antenna signals, I know that, because I know
well,
that doesn't work.
Well, in a diversity receiver, you don't mix antenna signals because I've got a left and a right antenna, A and B, and they go separately to the receiver. But there are cases, and I'll show you here, where I do have multiple antennas and I do mix them. But there's a way to get around the problem. If you're using multiple systems, again, we greatly encourage this, you can use passive splitters like this thing to split one antenna to feed two different things. In this case, I'm feeding the analyzer and the receiver from the same antenna. But if you have to split to multiple receivers, these active antenna distribution amplifiers are useful. The passive guy has about a 3 dB insertion loss, and the active ones are unity gain. And you can cascade these things to feed multiple receivers from one pair of antennas. You'd want to use wideband antennas here probably, because this is probably multiple frequency bands that I'm dealing with. But this scheme works for large-scale systems. So for remote antennas, use half waves or some wideband directional. Line of sight, maintain diversity separation, keep the total loss or gain to no more than plus or minus 5 dB. Amplifiers can make up for some of that gain. Here's the situation where we've got multiple antennas. This is the last bit. Sometimes it's the case I want to cover two different areas that are somewhat isolated, same set of wireless systems. I can put an AB pair in each area, passively connect the B antennas, passively connect the A antennas, and bring those back to the rack. And now any of the associated transmitters can be used in either of these rooms.
What if it was two sets of antennas, but to cover the same stage?
Yes. We're almost there.
Sorry.
Here's the typical hotel ballroom, dividable ballroom. In this case, we're claiming the air walls have so much metal in them, I can't get transmission to the walls, so I end up putting a pair of antennas into each area. And I passively connect the A antennas to stick some amplifiers in to make up for the losses back to the rack, and likewise the B antennas kind of daisy chain and back to the rack. What happens when I pull the air walls out of here? Now,
the
problem is that passively connected antennas form an antenna array, just like a loudspeaker array, multiple sources, in this case multiple destinations. And this array of A antennas will have some odd polar pattern with some nulls here and there. The B rig will be another sort of an array with some odd null patterns. But statistically, unless those antennas are co-located, the nulls will not be co-located. So as long as I can see at least one A antenna and one B antenna from wherever I am in here, the diversity circuitry will generally save my money.
One thing though, you're going to get weird. The time delays of the coax is going to have something to do with those nulls. No, because it's just
it.
Nanoseconds. It's nanoseconds. It's short radio frequencies.
Well, if you look at the velocity of signal through coax, it's typically about between two-thirds and 9/10 the speed of light.
Really?
Yeah. If you look at velocity of propagation through cable in the charts, the worst cable, like an RG58, is about 66% speed of light.
Yes.
The best stuff is about 85% speed of light. So, yes, there is a loss here, and there's, of course, loss in time between this antenna and that antenna if I'm standing over here. And that's why I get a null. If I'm just enough off-center, I create a time delay arrival.
But that's if you're at the far end, they'll team up. What if you're the close end? What if you're standing in room A, and so then the room B's A antenna, room A's A mm-hmm. antenna gets less delay than room B's A antenna, which gets even less delay than room C's A antenna.
So I'm going to have some odd polar pattern of these A antennas. And I'm going to have a similar odd polar pattern of the B antennas. But because they're not co-located, the nulls will not be co-located.
Unless you're
very unlucky. Thanks to multipath, though, we actually don't have as quite as bad a situation in an indoor environment as we might outdoors, but we have no reflective signal to also kind of smooth things out. So this actually worked quite well. As long as I can always see at least one A antenna, one B antenna, I'm good to go here. The four-room deal, this is the one that we run into periodically, the last example here. This is a large casino gaming floor. They do promotions and things out on the floor, so they want to have one guy with a microphone go everywhere on the gaming floor. This is about 300 feet long and about 200 feet wide.
Where is this?
This Lincoln Park Casino. I think it's State of New York or Vermont or somewhere?
Rhode Island.
Yeah. Is that the one?
Okay. Park, that's Rhode Island.
Well, there's a big structure. Now, I haven't been to this thing. I just did this from the drawings they sent me. But this apparently is a large sort of lounge bar area with a lot of metal structure. So it couldn't get transmission through this part of the room. Otherwise, you could put a couple of antennas over here and probably cover most of the room from one spot. So the solution in this case was to put a series of dipole antennas hanging down from the ceiling, basically. So B, A, B, A, B, A, B, A, B, A, all the way around. And the like ones are daisy-chained together. Same with the A's. And all the receivers are back here. Well, all the receivers is one receiver. So to do this, since this is hundreds of feet of coax, and it had to be the plenum rated LMR 400, which is about $4 a foot. The antenna rig probably cost $4,000 to put up these antennas and cable and so forth. And through that, they attached a $600 wireless system. But it's a casino that made it back in 10 minutes or so. And it worked fine. The guy could stand anywhere out here, and you could always see at least one antenna and one B antenna, and he's okay. But this is just an example of a multi-antenna system. But the key is you've got to be able to see at least one of each, or the diversity circuitry has nothing to work with in a multipath, or a null from the weird pattern will kill you. So that's the way we do it sometimes.
This is all FM transmission.
It's all FM now.
Yeah. So you also have issues in the receiver with capture ratio and signal noise.
If there's interference.
Selectivity
signals
and so forth.
Right.
So those can be used to your advantage in a case like this, I guess, with the receiver.
To some extent. And that actually, when he talked about FM reception, you have competing signals on the same frequency. If one of them is at least 20 dB stronger than the other, that typically captures the receiver, and the interfering signal is ignored. So it's important not to have too much gain in the antenna rig, where you start to amplify low-level signals that would ordinarily be ignored, up to the point where they start to be strong as the signal you're trying to get. So we often run into this problem where there's just way too much gain in the antenna systems. People will do a scan with the wireless workbench, And that thing will go across, it's just solid red stuff all the way across. And the receiver reports no frequencies found. And I'm looking at the TV chart, there's like 8 open TV channels. What do you mean no frequencies found? Yeah, I ran it, it's all red, no frequencies. So where are your antennas? Oh, they're right here. What's near there? Well, my 10 PSM transmitters with their antenna aimed right at the wireless mic receive antennas from 2 feet away. No, you can't do that. And then they've got paddle antennas set to plus 10 with 10 dB gain amps and 5 feet of RG8. You know, there's no loss.
All
this gain. Right. It's completely crushing the receiver. So, but audio and radio are not always alike in this regard. Too much RF is a problem. And it's just something to consider. So, this is what I have to present here. So, and boy, we went to way over here. But if there's any other questions, I'd be happy to entertain a couple here. Otherwise, I'd really like to thank the AES folks for inviting me to come out here while I was in town. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
And thank you.